arbitrary population centers. This is your classic deterrent by punishment strategy. Nuclear weapons don't need to be on high alert. Retaliation doesn't need to be immediate, it just needs to be certain. And you don't need tactical nuclear weapons. You're not using nuclear weapons on conventional forces that might be attacking. So this allows for much more centralized death management if that's your aim. If your aim is to deter conventional weapons, right, this was U.S. NATO during the Cold War. We had conventional inferiority in Europe. In order to offset the conventional capability of the war office, the United States needed nuclear weapons, threat of tactical nuclear weapons, to offset that difference. And we need a threat to use nuclear weapons first. Warsaw Pact nuclear conventional forces can crash into Western Europe. The United States very explicitly threatened to use tactical nuclear weapons against the Warsaw Pact forces. Right? Unlike in the assured retaliation, hey, look, I have a no for you problem. I won't use nuclear weapons against them. Primarily strategic weapons. Compared to here, you have a very forward, aggressive, active nuclear weapons capability. Where you have to threaten to use nuclear weapons if you're trying to prevent it. And it kind of looks like a denial and punishment. Right? And now regional powers are pushing what can anyone guess where India falls? I'm sure to tell you, yeah, they have conventional security against Pakistan. Not really worried about China invading India, marching all the way to primarily trying to deter the Chinese against the Where does Pakistan go? What does Pakistan do? So Pakistan is primarily worried about Indian marching. And having been at the receiving end of dismemberment of India, I just think they want to help out. Pakistan is operating on the marching very aggressive. Very important battlefield nuclear weapons, Indian across the world. So they have a first, I call it asymmetric escalation. They threaten to escalate a conventional conflict very quickly because earlier than India would, before any other nuclear weapons, because they're worried about Indian conventional nuclear warning. Pakistan actually started its nuclear program before India attended the so-called nuclear program. On the heels of the 1970s, I'll talk about this in a second. So India's security environment historically, right, there has the 1960s war with China, which is its conventional performance shock to the Indian army and the Indian Chinese performed so much better than Indian people in India. 2 years later, China tested its nuclear weapons. So, Indian military program gets its motivation initially from its experiences in 62-64 in China. And to avoid nuclear coercion, future against China. India hedges under the Nehru years and the subsequent leadership of the Soviet Union. It does also have a persistent war with Pakistan, but it has conventional superiority. And there was really never any talk about either nuclear weapons or the Pakistan. But India had a civilian nuclear program, right? It got a cannon ready. Some of the underwater flybys now, 54 trucks, 54. And then in 1974, Indira Gandhi authorizes what's known at the time under the Adams program, there was a category known as the Nuclear Explosion Program, which was, I mean, there were legitimate uses it was believed at the time for this, like, you need a clear large swath of land for the dam. Right, and India had some potential uses for this, but didn't really fool it. I mean, a peaceful nuclear explosion killed Hitler, but it wasn't, however, a warhead, right? I mean, this thing was a rickety, I think it was 8 meters in diameter device. I mean, it was hulking, unstable, rickety, fission device in 1996. It wasn't suitable for a military purpose, right? It wasn't miniaturized. It didn't have, it wasn't even suitable for delivery by aircraft. You have to throw it out the back of a cargo plane, right? I mean, it still gave them certainly the physics of being able to sustain fission. Spherical compression. All of that was there was a plutonium device. So it wasn't trivial, but it wasn't a nuclear weapon in the sense of that we think of. So a lot of work was still yet to be done after 1954, but it demonstrated that Indian scientists had the ability to at least design rudimentary nuclear weapons. And there's several explanations for why it's 1974. The general security environment that's not going to China. Persistent wars with Pakistan. They just won the 1970 war with Pakistan. 1971 war with Pakistan. We split Pakistan in two. I'll talk about that. That was a real motivation for the Pakistani program. But the real explanation is a combination of domestic politics and the power of the scientists. So Indira Gandhi was facing a potential series of losses in the state government. She wanted a big win. There were several very prominent Indian physicists and engineers who promised a big boost in her electoral fortunes if she tested a nuclear weapon. They really wanted to test a nuclear weapon. They've been working on it, and they had been doing this persistently for several years, and she then found her opportunity in 1974 when, right before she was made election, she authorized the test. Spiritually, the test didn't actually help her that much, but there was a belief that it might, and developed some of the motivation for it. So from 1974 until about 1989, for about 15 years, India's nuclear program went into effective dormancy. There was no high-level authorization from Indira Gandhi or her son to live against Prime Minister after the assassination in 1984. For the militarization of the program. So, India scientists worked on some of the theoretical work for militarization, getting India in a place where it had to militarize the program it could, but there was no actual physical work done on that after 1972. Pakistan faced a somewhat different security environment, right? So, whereas India lost the 1964 and then faced China's nuclear test, but never really faced the threat of a massive conventional invasion from China. Really wanting nuclear weapons to deter the Chinese nuclear threat, not the Chinese conventional threat. Pakistan was really scarred by the 1971. The 1971 war was the war in which East Pakistan was birthed into Bangladesh. Right, so there was a refugee crisis of West Pakistan and East. Pakistan at birth in 1947 was split and non-contiguous with India in the middle. You had East and West Pakistan. West Pakistan was dominated by Punjabi. East Pakistan was dominated by Bengali. Right, so there was ethnic tension between Punjabi and Bengali. Punjabi dominated the politics of Pakistan. Bengali felt like there were second-class citizens in Pakistan that created political tension. There was an uprising in 1971. India intervened on behalf of the Bengalis to split East Pakistan off of West Pakistan. Now, if you're India, this is a huge victory, right? You had two flanks of Pakistan surrounding you, and you were able to make them, two independent countries, right? With the benefit that you helped birth Bangladesh. From Bangladesh, from Pakistan. So, it's not like there would be allies against you in the conference. So strategically, this worked out pretty well for India. But for West Pakistan, now present-day Pakistan, this is a pretty searing moment, right? Your east wing is amputated, and it was at the hands of the Indians, right? So as early as 1965, when it became clear that India might look into this.